Good evening, Sector 001. TJ Esnack here, your host for the Jupiter Station podcast. Tonight, our guest really needs no introduction. You know him as an artist and actor of stage and screen, as well as a writer. You also know him as Hemmer from season one of Star Trek Strange New Worlds. Please welcome today's guest, Bruce Horak.
Oh, hello. Good evening.
How are you, Bruce? Thanks for joining us tonight.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
So I ask all my guests, there might be somebody somewhere on the planet who doesn't know you. Can you give us a little bit of background?
Sure. I am a performer and a creator. I live in Canada. I'm a Canadian by birth. I was born and raised in Calgary, Alberta, where I went to theater school, and I spent most of my career on stage across the country, performing and creating my own work. I am visually impaired. I lost 91% of my eyesight to bilateral retinoblastoma when I was just a baby. So I am legally blind, which basically means I can't drive a car, but I fake it pretty well. And I had a lot of people fooled for a number of years that I could see. And in my probably mid-30s, I got my very first white cane and as officially accepted and came out as a visually impaired or blind person. And as a result of accepting and moving into the world of being a disabled performer, opportunities started to present themselves, including the opportunity to audition to play the role of a blind alien named Hemmer on Star Trek Strange New Worlds. In 2020, I was offered the role, and I performed as Hemmer in, I think, 5 or 6 episodes in season one. And it just completely changed my life.
It completely changed ours, too. That was a dynamic character. I got to say, I definitely miss him.
Yeah, me too. He was great.
So along that line, being diagnosed at such an early age with retinoblastoma, how did the early diagnosis affect your upbringing, basically, or how you proceeded on with life?
It's interesting. I'm the youngest of 4 boys, and they were, my older brothers really, yeah, they challenged me to keep up, and they didn't really ever see me as being the blind younger brother. They taught me to do things like ride a bike and play soccer and figure out ways that I could adapt to the world. It was a mantra growing up that it is a sighted world and it's up to me to figure out how to adapt. And so I went to an integrated school. All of my friends were fully sighted. And I, from a very young age, started to use technology in order to figure out how to adapt to the world. That included a little telescope that I would use to read the blackboard from the back of the room. I also took typing lessons, which was kind of unheard of at the time. I mean, this was 1983 or whatever. So I was in grade 3 taking typing lessons and figuring out. I got a computer. I got computer illiterate very early on. At least rudimentarily so. And it was really a process of adaptation for a sighted world. And it was a challenge to appear to be sighted when my vision was so limited. But there was a lot of tricks and ways of kind of adapting and moving through the world. I think I ultimately got so good at it that there are some of my very close friends through theater school who had no idea that I had such limited eyesight. And it was really only later in my life, as I started to take up visual art, actually. A friend of mine asked me, how do you navigate the world? How do you see the world? And so I started painting portraits in 2011. And that process of trying to figure out how it is that I see, instead of figuring out how the rest of the world sees, actually figuring out how I see, has completely changed and altered and shifted my creative process. And it is a much deeper and more settled process than trying to constantly adapt to the stimulus of the world as it was. I do tend to babble. I'm sorry about that.
Oh, don't be. I babble too. And in fact, I read about your visual art. There was a show you were doing somewhere in Canada, and at one point you had painted a portrait of the entire audience. And I found that to be absolutely fascinating.
Yeah, the show is called Assassinating Thompson, and I've been touring it for, gosh, 11 years now. And in the play, it's a one-man show, I paint a portrait of the entire audience, which on a large, kind of probably about that large canvas. And I tell the story of how I lost my eyesight, how I came to be a visually impaired visual artist. And I solved the mystery of who killed Tom Thompson. And Tom Thompson was a Canadian artist who died mysteriously in 1917. And he just kind of paddled, I mean, in typical Canadian fashion, you know, he paddled off across a lake and disappeared. A canoe lake, actually, was the name of the lake. And his body surfaced like 10 days later. And there's all sorts of speculation about foul play and who did it and la la. So over the course of my painting, the portrait, I tell the ghost story and the mystery, and I solve it in 75 minutes. And then at the end of the show, I turn the canvas around so the audience can see what I've been working on. And then I auction off the canvas and donate the proceeds to a local charity or a charity organization. Last year, I toured to 25 different communities throughout Manitoba and Ontario. And over the course of the 25 shows, we managed to raise over $10,000 for an organization in Canada called Canadian Guide Dogs for the Blind, which trains and pairs seeing eye dogs with visually impaired and blind people who need them. That's a pretty amazing organization, and I'm always happy to raise money for them.
And that is absolutely fascinating, Bruce. What inspired you to become an actor?
I just really didn't want to get a real job. No, I have a very artistic family. My dad was an English teacher, and he actually started out as a drama teacher. So, we just, you know, dad introduced me to theater and to plays and movies. And I have three older brothers who are all artistically inclined. I got addicted to laughter. Making my classmates laugh was one of the most addictive things ever. And it's that desire to entertain, I think, was primary for me. I loved getting lost in a character. I loved just performing and entertaining. And to me, there's nothing better than a group of people who are moved to spontaneously laugh. That's just the most addictive thing. And the applause is pretty sweet too.
I can only imagine. So would you consider yourself a role model for a young person with a visual impairment?
Oh, not a very good one. I have lots of advice to my younger self. I think that's any mark of a good mentor is that all advice is self-motivation, really. Through the course of my touring and doing theater, I've encountered a lot of young people who've definitely expressed that they are inspired. I think if anything, my desire is for any blocked creative, anyone who considers themselves a creative or who is creative curious or creative adjacent, to come and see one of my shows or to encounter my art and be inspired to do it themselves. I know I spent a long, long time and still do really like almost on the daily of questioning the validity of it and my technique or talent or whatever it is and all that internal stuff that stops me from creating. And, I get through it through practice and through great mentors that I've been fortunate to encounter. If I can provide that kind of inspiration for someone else who wants to follow a creative life, then I feel it's a pretty good job.
Wow, that is deep.
Thank you.
Along that line, in Strange New Worlds, Hemmer is a blind Aenar who is a very independent individual and doesn't necessarily like it when Uhura offers assistance. What is your response when others offer assistance?
Ah, that's a good question. It depends on what the assistance is for. If it's something that I am competent and capable of doing, then I will often just say, thank you, I've got this. There's it's a struggle because I don't want to be seen as being less than, but there are other opportunities where someone can step in and really help me out. I really noticed this. I mean, just going back to when I got my first white cane, I was in my 30s, and I really fought against having a white cane because I knew it would identify me immediately as someone who was visually impaired. And I fought against that for a long time. I didn't want to be pigeonholed as someone who was visually impaired. And so as soon as I got a contact lens and I could walk around without my glasses on, like, I did everything I possibly could to appear to be fully sighted. And getting the white cane meant really just kind of admitting that I'm visually impaired and all the stigma that goes with. Oftentimes someone will see a white cane and assume I can't see anything, right? So you're kind of stuck in this world of somebody grabbing my arm, for instance, on the street corner to take me across the street, and so, well, I can see enough to know that the traffic had stopped and that it was our turn to go, and suddenly I'm being sort of thrown into this. And I know in my heart of hearts that's coming from a place of someone wanting to help and someone to be caring, but it can be a bit jarring, and also it's an invasion of privacy or personal space. So you have to, kind of balance and weigh those things out, where if I felt it was coming from a place of belittlement to lessen me in some way, then there's that opportunity to kind of stand up and say, no, I can do this. And I think oftentimes I surprise other people, but oftentimes I surprise myself with the things that I can do, thinking that, well, there's no way that a person with 9% eyesight could possibly, do what I do. Learning to juggle, for instance, I never thought I'd be able to do that. And then, over time, I figured out a way to do these things. Oftentimes, it's just having a lot of patience. So maybe it comes down to just patience and compassion, I hope.
I'd probably lean more towards the patience. So when my brother caught wind that I was interviewing you, he went a little crazy. He's like, wait, you're interviewing Bruce Horak? How the heck did you do that? I'm like, I'm just that good. Actually, I was just that lucky because I ended up messaging you on Facebook, and you said, yeah, reach out to my assistant. And yeah, Elvis has been amazing getting all this stuff lined up, by the way.
Great.
So but glad. He had a question, and it came out so humongously geek, like I had to kind of edit it a little bit. I'm like, you want me to ask him what? But okay. He said, did you find it difficult to balance the inherent pacifism of the Aenar with the occasional need for violence in the position your character held?
I'd need an example of the need for violence.
Yeah, what me too. I didn't really find him very violent. I mean, maybe towards the end of season one, like when they were fighting the Gorn, but even so, that wasn't aggressive violence, that was defensive violence.
This is it. It's a good question, because I wondered about that in that final episode where he's the one who presses the button that freezes the Gorn. Is that an act of violence? It's protecting Lan as she climbs into that case. Potentially they could thaw the Gorn out. I don't know.
I'm not sure I'd really want a Gorn thawn out personally. I mean, no, if they're frozen, let them freeze.
Yeah, exactly. Cool. Yeah. And then Yeah, it's a good question. I kind of wrestled with that a little bit myself. I have to give it up to the writers to, you know, they can kind of wrestle with the philosophy and the philosophical conundrum of whether that's actually an act of violence or is it any better than vaporizing it with a phaser? Not that they could, but it's a deep question. Thank you, brother.
I most definitely thank him. He's the last few years he's been kind of a closet Trekkie, but I'm trying to draw him back out a little bit more. That being said, how long have you been a fan of Star Trek?
Oh, since I was a kid. Yeah, I can't remember a time in my life before Star Trek. It was on reruns in the 80s when we were growing up, and my dad was a huge fan of sci-fi in general and certainly Star Trek. We watched it like every Sunday night as a family gathered around the TV with popcorn and doing our Shatner impressions. And then when Next Generation came out, I think my dad had just retired or maybe it was before. Anyway, when it came out, it was definitely another going down the rabbit hole with that show all the way through. And, you know, I lost track of it probably through Voyager and Deep Space Nine. But I came back to it again, just love the show. And certainly when the pandemic hit and we were all in lockdown, it was great distraction. Like I went hard through Voyager, and I had a little keyboard set up in my living room. I was learning the piano, and I would get up and play the theme song along with it. That's how much of a nerd I was. Instead of skipping through the song, I sat down and just play along. Yeah.
Oh, I have to say, like I got very much more back into watching Star Trek during the pandemic myself. Mm-hmm. Like what was it? I ended up missing out on like the last three seasons of DS9 on their first run. So I never actually got to experience like 5, 6, and 7 until I was an adult living on my own. Years later, watching reruns.
Yeah, and those are the great seasons.
Oh, that's when the moral strife came out to play, and Ben Sisko became not just another captain, but like, you know, the captain who gets stuff done.
Yeah.
Along with that, I just had a thought along that line. I was talking with. Oh, who the heck was I talking with? Oh, I was talking with Stephanie Chikowski a few episodes ago. I interviewed her, and she had mentioned that, you know, Trek is this one gigantic family, and it's definitely one of those things that unites people and gives hope. So I can totally see how people watching Star Trek and all those reruns through the pandemic, it was definitely something that got a lot of people through.
Definitely.
Along the sci-fi route, and I totally forgot to write this down, I remember watching you in an episode of Warehouse 13.
Yeah.
You played the inventor of the television.
Philo Farnsworth. Mm-hmm. Based on a real guy. Yeah. Yeah. He also invents the device that they use to track all the lost articles. And yeah.
And I mean, I got my start on sci-fi through Star Trek, and then my dad introduced me to things like, you know, 2001 A Space Odyssey or the Andromeda Strain, and just the various levels of sci-fi that Star Trek started me on. And then I got to enjoy Warehouse 13, Eureka, all those shows that came to sci-fi. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Star Trek has no idea how pivotal it is in the experience of so many of our generation, especially.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Like I'll sit down and I'll watch Star Trek with my kids and like, why did you do that, Dad? Because he's the captain. He has to. Yeah. But couldn't you just just don't poke a hole in my show. Just you sit there and enjoy it. Don't poke a hole in my show. like if you watch like Strange New Worlds, when you and Captain Pike and all the crew came out and used phasers, a lot of that was like actual tactical maneuvering that we use currently versus like just having it, you know, at the hip and let's shoot the Gorn and see if we can hit it. You know, so I think the way the roles have evolved since the very first episodes of the original Star Trek has completely changed.
Yeah. Yeah.
I gotta ask, Mirror Universe Hemmer, what do you think he's like?
I've never thought of that. Wow. I have no idea. I wonder if I wonder if the Aenar would even exist. Like as pacifists, if they would have even, if they would have made it. I mean, and certainly Starfleet would be more of a military organization. So I wonder if they've just like dug themselves buried, like not even come out from the wastelands of Andoria. Yeah.
Like we're just going to hide here till the humans leave.
Yeah. Of course, in the mirror universe, everything is flipped. So maybe they're like ultra aggressive, right?
I asked Todd Stashwick the same question. And I asked him what mirror universe Shaw would be like. And he said, oh, Ice Cream Man. And I'm like, and like, just the thought process was like, did you really just say that? Like, what? Ice Cream Man? What, flying around in a shuttle? Like the good humor shuttlecraft? What?
Sure, I can see that.
But that's the awesome thing. Like, you know, our love of Star Trek has probably increased our level of imagination. So, you know, you and I can have this conversation and we know exactly what we're thinking. But if somebody has never, you know, watched Star Trek as close as we have, or they're completely new to the genre and we start rattling off with something and they look at us like we have nine heads. Yeah. And you just look at them like, oh, it's a Trek thing. You'll understand soon enough.
Yeah.
Have you gotten a chance since becoming part of the Star Trek family to meet LeVar Burton and kind of talk about his character, Geordi, who was also sight impaired?
I did have the chance to meet LeVar Burton this last summer at Star Trek Las Vegas. It was during the actor strike in the States. And so that convention, we were not allowed to talk about any struck content that included Star Trek episode, like series pass, upcoming stuff or anything. So we weren't, you know, in the rooms in front of the fans and all that. And at the convention proper, we weren't able to talk about the characters, but I was put on a panel with it was the engineers of Star Trek. So there was myself and LeVar Burton and Garrett Wong was there, and Trip Tucker was the actor.
Connor Trinneer.
Connor Trinneer, thank you. And we were all on a panel together, but they put us into kind of a VIP lounge beforehand to talk. And that's when I first met LeVar Burton. It was very emotional, actually, as we were just kind of talking about around the shows, and they were asking, someone in the room just asked about being a visually impaired actor and how and what that was like. And I kind of explained my process and what it was like to walk onto a set. I was trying to be as vague as possible, but onto a set and the kind of help that I required and what was afforded to me by being on such a big set. And LeVar Burton just, he was so gracious. He was so kind. And he just said, I'll never forget it. He said, you're an inspiration to me. He's like, I think the struggles that actors get to just getting to a role, but then on top of that, having a disability, I mean, that's a pretty extraordinary thing. We didn't speak about Geordi and what that was like for him, and kind of the comparisons between the two characters. But it was a really profound moment for me. I remember watching Next Generation and seeing and the evolution that goes through even I think it's into the movies where he gets implants and all of that. It's an extraordinary thing. I think about that all the time, of like where the technology is going, with implants and artificial eyes. And, you know, I use my phone as my eyes sometimes. And, you know, 25 years ago, that was unheard of. You know, I would never deign to travel across the country by myself. And now, because I have a cell phone with GPS and maps and, you know, instant connection and communication, I can read a menu, I can read street signs across the way, I can Google Translate if I want to. Like, being a visually impaired person in the world now is made and afforded so much more ease because of the technology that we have available to us. And I think, you know, we can draw a correlation between the technology that we have and the vision of people like Gene Roddenberry and those people who are fanatics of science fiction. My father was a high school English teacher, and he wrote his master's thesis on developing a science fiction course for high school students. And one of the pillars of that course is engaging and activating the imagination. Look at what you have right now. Think of a problem that we have, and how do you solve it using your creativity and through technology, science? Where could it possibly go? And it's the question of possibility. What is possible out there that spurs, I think, the imagination and the storytelling? And going back to your point earlier about hope, because it's through the imagination. We imagine a better future. We imagine a better possibility. And through that imagining, we activate our options, and we activate ourselves to move toward that, not only individually, but as a species. And I think that is the greatest thing that a show like Star Trek has provided, a great deal of hope.
And along that vein, so many of us watched it during the pandemic, and it gave us that hope. And when I'm not a podcast host, I'm a school bus driver and a firefighter and an EMT. And obviously, the school buses weren't running during the pandemic, so I got to stay at home and basically wait for the call to go to the firehouse. And sure enough, that call would come, and I'm like, ooh, do I really want to go out? Like, there's COVID out there, and there's crazy people out there. And I'm like, yeah, it's worth it, because I'm trained to do something and to be able to go out and help somebody. Yeah. But along with that, like, you and I both know that if COVID had happened during Star Trek, Dr. McCoy would have injected himself with the vaccine and said, okay, let's see if it works.
He'd be the first one to do it. Yeah.
You know, so when it came time for, you know, me to get my vaccine with the firehouse crew, I'm like, yep, right there. Like, hit me with it. And everybody's like, oh, aren't you afraid of growing another tail? I'm like, I'll try anything once.
Good for you.
And let me see, I have a question for you, and then I'm gonna close out the interview, and then if it's okay with you, I'll kind of pop back into the green room, we can chat a little bit.
Sure thing.
Perfect. You've gotten the chance to guest on a few shows, as well as had your time on stage. What was your favorite role that you've played
ever,
like in all time to date?
That's a really hard question. That is a really, really hard question. I don't know. You know, the first one that comes to mind is the Scarecrow in The Wizard of Oz, which is I grew up reading the books, the L. Frank Baum series. My again, going back to my dad, but he was a comic collector, and he collected old, like, first edition books. So we had all the first edition Wizard of Oz in hardcover, and the Scarecrow of Oz, which is the one, it was just falling apart. It was like my favorite of the L. Frank Baum series. And I just, I love that character, and getting to do, I mean, it's one of the only plays that I have ever, I saw the audition. I was in Toronto, and I like caught a red eye to fly back to Calgary to audition for it. I've never done like that, at least until Star Trek. I've never done that amount of work for a role before. I wanted it so badly. And when I landed it, I just delighted. And it was, it was a wonderful, wonderful opportunity and a really great experience as well. It's just, to me, it was physical. It was funny. It's heartwarming. And it's just a classic story for sure. The Scarecrow. And then recently, actually, I got to provide the voice for an accessible, they're doing an accessible audiobook of The Wizard of Oz. Sometime it will come out. And I got to perform as do the lines of dialogue, which was really nice to go back to do that.
Oh, that is awesome. And
I should have said hammer.
Well, I mean, here's one. So you can confirm, and nobody seems to believe me when I tell them, but in the musical episode, which is like drawn right down the middle, half the people loved it, half the people hated it. I'm one of the people who loved it. I thought it was brilliant. Nobody's ever done anything like that before. So there was definitely some pioneering. But a lot of people think I'm crazy when I say that you are actually the Klingon captain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. General Garkog. That's me.
Yeah. I told my brother, he said, nah. I'm like, yes, yes. Hammer was the Klingon. Yes, absolutely.
That's me. That was so much fun to do. It really was. Yeah.
Well, Bruce, thank you for joining us tonight. I tell all my guests that this usually will go to Sunday night at midnight. I'm going to see if I can get some of my post-production done quickly so I can get it out sooner. And if that's the case, I'll send an email to Elvis and let him know.
Fantastic. But
it was really a great honor to have you on tonight. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you and for having me.
I will see you in the green room momentarily.
Sounds good. Take care.
And in other news, at least two celebrities with Star Trek Picard are hopeful that the spinoff idea of Star Trek Legacy is still happening. It's been a really rough year with a lot of fans. The Strange New World series finale, delays in shows, and of course the strikes that happened this fall have all contributed to a dramatic loss of Trek. Certainly the current situation with Paramount Plus and their loss of funding is definitely going to add to that. Todd Stashwick and Michelle Hurd both are very hopeful that Legacy happens. Todd Stashwick was quoted at the Saturn Awards saying, it's all speculation. It's Schrodinger's legacy, right? There's a future where it happens and there's a future where it doesn't happen. I swear I've been told nothing. I can only be helpful because I would love to keep telling stories. Michelle Hurd has been quoted at the same event as saying, I'm hoping they're going to do it. I'm trying to manifest it and just put it out there because I really feel like it's something that has to happen. But considering how messy Paramount has been over the last few years, it's very likely no one knows if it's going to happen. Pocket Books has announced Star Trek Strange New Worlds novel to piece together the backstory of Una and Pike. Star Trek Strange New Worlds Asylum has been announced by Pocket Books. It arrives on September 24th, 2024, and looks like it will bounce back and forth between Pike and Una serving on the Enterprise and their first meeting years earlier. You can pre-order Asylum in hardcover and Kindle ebook now at Amazon.com. And finally, Paramount Plus is considering a streaming partnership with Peacock. According to Anthony Pascal of CheckMovie.com, the future of the home of Star Trek TV continues to be in flux, with a new report on Paramount Plus potentially joining forces with the Peacock streaming service. The Wall Street Journal is reporting that Paramount Global and Comcast are exploring joining forces in streaming through a partnership or joint venture among several potential strategic options. Like Paramount Plus, Comcast Peacock streaming service has struggled to compete in the streaming wars, with neither service turning a profit. Both services hover around 1% of the total TV viewing market share, compared to around 8% for market leader Netflix. Paramount has already formed a number of strategic partnerships for Paramount Plus, including Walmart, the world's largest retailer. Last year, it was reported that they were in talks on bundling Paramount Plus with Apple Plus. However, it sounds like the deal with Comcast could be more than just a marketing bundle, potentially combining Paramount Plus and Peacock into a single streaming service. According to the Wall Street Journal report, bringing the two streaming apps under one roof could produce significant cost savings, from spending on programming to marketing, and create a more in-depth offering for consumers, especially with regard to live sports. This new report follows last week's news that Disney, Fox, and Warner Brothers Discovery plan to launch their own combined streaming sports venture. This is not the first time that Comcast and Paramount have discussed a partnership, and the two companies have already combined forces with the Sky Showtime streaming service available in a number of markets in Europe, which features Peacock and Paramount Plus originals, including Star Trek, Strange New Worlds, and Prodigy. A combined service could see Star Trek sitting alongside reruns of The Office, NBC Universal and DreamWorks franchises, Peacock originals like Mrs. Davis and Poker Face, and Premier League football. More news on this can be seen at CheckMovie.com. Ladies and gentlemen, thanks for joining us this week. I am really glad that Bruce Horak was able to join us this week. Keep your eyes peeled. I do have a lot of stuff in the works. If you have any ideas, comments, questions, gripes, complaints, you can definitely email me at executive.producer@jupiterstationpodcast. Follow us on Facebook. Follow us on TikTok. Follow us on Instagram. We are online and our social media is strong. I'm TJ Esnack, your host. Have a great week.